Today, our guest is Robin Chandler, who is the chairperson of the Department of African American Studies at Northeastern University, and a colleague and friend of mine is here to speak on what she entitles the blue pill or the red pill, taking IT to youth audiences. Robin would talk to us specifically about her hip-hop tutorial and recognizing that there's a variety of people in the audiences, or in the audience she wants to give us an opportunity to sort of let her get familiar with where we're situated so she can see how she can connect her presentation with your interests, which can be difficult at times. Robin is an artist. She has worked in the media of collage, photography, computerized imaging, and creative writing for many years. Her work appears in many public and private spaces, colleges, and in the United States and throughout the world. She considers herself not only an artist, but an educator, a poet, and a writer. Robin hails from Massachusetts, and she has a PhD in sociology from Northeastern University. And I'd like to welcome her and not take too much time in the presentation. You'll learn more about her. But there's one other piece I'd like to share with you. Robin and I became colleagues through our work with the Institute for African American E-Culture. And that is a virtual institute of African American scholars around the country who are looking at issues relating to the digital divide in the African American community. We're doing some very interesting work. We'd like to invite you to look at our website as well as Robin's website, and we'll give you that information before you leave. So I'm going to turn things over.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming. I want to say a few things before I start, because bios never really tell you what you really want to know about who is this person. I mean, it's kind of interesting on paper, but you don't get a palpable sense of who the individual was. And I'd like to start that off by asking you all, when was the last time you actually wrote a letter with your hand, with like pen and ink or a pencil? Think now. Write a letter. It's a type.
Your post-it notes count?
No.
I actually wrote a note 2 weeks ago. Wrote a stationery and the whole thing.
Okay, but you wrote it.
I wrote him.
You didn't type
no.
it. Okay, looks like you're the only one.
No. Yeah, oh. I probably the last one. Thank you, kind of letter. I think.
A thank you letter.
Card.
I wrote a letter to my cousin.
A letter, mm-hmm. Handwritten.
Yeah. Yeah, I wrote a letter.
You wrote a letter.
Yeah,
a thank you card.
No, thank you card.
Cards don't count.
Thank
you.
Yeah,
those post-it notes.
Yeah, okay, I'll have to make a new list now. Thank you, cards and post-it notes.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm talking like thinking about expressing your feelings and your ideas over an extended period of what I think a number of us who are, I dare say, what, over 40, maybe even 35, used to do, which was actually write letters. And the acceleration of technology between that time, when I remember writing letters home from summer camp. Remember, they were requesting care packages from your parents. Please send me. Long list of things. And getting, you know, letters and cards back, some of which I still have. But the short story is that when I was doing my PhD, I had to word process it. It was just when computers just sort of came out. And that literally was pretty much all I did. I had been a visual artist before I was a sociologist, and I had no idea what the capacity of a computer was to actually make available and possible for me all of the visual-based technologies, all of the CAD-CAM that would subsequently come about after I did my PhD. It was really through, I think, tripping into, by accident, Photoshop, Premiere, Illustrator, and several other macromedia filming, all that sort of stuff. Just sitting at the computer, which, as you know, you can do for a very long time and get hemorrhoids if you're not really careful. So you have to like take this judiciously and not sit for 6 hours at a time, which is what I did, because when I first realized what the capacity was for visual applications, I just lost control. I had no more boundaries anymore. I literally was in cyberspace full time. And that's where I've been since. And if we have time, I'll take you to my website. If we don't have time now, you can go to it on your own. It's just www.robin-chandler.com. It's very simple. And go through and enjoy it. It really was meant for pleasure and enjoyment, not so much just to get information. But there's a lot of visual stimulation, I think, that you'll get from it. And it really, I think, probably better describes than anything else where I came from and where I've ended up. So my interest in technology came from those two sources, originally with the exposure with word processing and subsequently with experimenting with a whole lot of visual media. I think the first experience I had that was overwhelming was this website was preceded by another website, which I designed by myself. And one day my daughter came home and I was literally hanging over the desktop, cursing and swearing. And, "What's the matter, Mom? Well, I can't get this code to match up with this image, and I can't download this properly, and everything's just really off." And she said, "Well, you should not have done it that way, Mom." And I said, "I don't understand." She said, "You multitasked." I said, "What do you mean I multitasked?" She said, "You did everything. You created the images from scratch, you wrote the code, you designed the layout, you created the text, you did everything." She said, "No one does that." I said, "Why didn't someone tell me?" She said, "It was much too much fun watching you." So the website that I have now is actually based on my own learning experience, that is not something that I was good at doing, not something that I wanted to do, and there were people much better equipped and talented than me to do that kind of thing. But I had this huge visual database from being an artist for 20 years. I had to do something with it. I had all these raw images, and I'm sure there's an enormous amount of pilfering and thievery that goes on my website that I don't know about. I know there is. Because it's a very kind of unusual situation to have this much of a history of a visual database that goes back to the 70s of every single image that I've ever created, because I first started scanning them in many, many years ago when there was capacity to do that. So I became really fascinated with multimedia, not particularly because I liked it, but because it did interesting things. The other thing I noticed, which is probably something that many of you, at least those of you who are older, have experienced, is this idea of multitasking in young people and the differences in learning styles that cross generations. And another encounter I had with my child at one point at which I asked her to teach me how to do a certain technology that was very baseline, nothing particularly brilliant. And she said, I'm not sure how to do that, Mom. You'll have to talk to the 8-year-olds because they're the ones that know how to program the computer or whatever it was for a particular television show. So I'm realizing over time that not only is Murphy's Law coming true, not only is technology accelerating every 18 months, it's accelerating much faster than that. And in order to really deal with the issues that many of us at the Institute of African American E-Culture and many others who are interested in coming up with solutions to the digital divide and making IT available to people of color, women, youngsters, particularly young girls as well as young boys, is to begin to look at culturally specific ways of learning and knowing and doing. And so it means for me that my interest in sociology just worked out really neat in terms of IAAEC. I'm kind of the token sociologist now that there are a couple of more younger people coming along. I'm not the only one. But it's this very interesting idea of working with a group of interdisciplinary scholars. The Institute for African American E-Culture received a grant from the National Science Foundation a year and a half ago called New Approaches to Human Capital Development in Information Technology Research. And it is a multi-million dollar, multi-year grant that is comprised of a number of scholars of African-American background from across the country, from a number of different institutions, both academic and non-academic. Most of the folks are science-based, so I am really an odd man out. I mean, Renee is kind of sort of too, except she's got colleagues who are in the educational assessment too. And so one of the things that's been really intriguing about working with this interdisciplinary group of people who are really, really brilliant and who have lots of letters after their name, all of whom have brown faces of various hues, is that you have made certain assumptions about working with people of color, that just because they're people of color and just because they're academics, that you have some common language. Well, I promise you, there was no, and has not always been, a common language in this group. And by that I mean, I began working with Bryant York, who was one of the founders of IAAEC in the early 90s. And Bryant is a mathematician and a computer scientist. I was a visual artist and a sociologist, and we got thrown together to write a grant for an international piece of international research I was doing. It's taken us that long to find ways to talk to one another across our professional disciplines, because most of the time I had no idea what he was talking about. I'd catch maybe every seventh word. And he was the same for me. He had no idea about how social scientists think, let alone aesthetic and artistic ideas that I brought to the table as well. So one of the things I want to do is walk you through the project that I'm doing for the IAAEC grant. My ITR is called the Hip Hop Tutorial Project. And it is basically a twofold project. The first is to create a tutorial or a reader to teach young college-age youth to go into after school, particularly after school, some school-based settings, and using their own discipline that they're studying in school to develop lesson plans that have information technology and multimedia applications to design a lesson plan that they can teach to kids in this setting. So the idea is the three R's, even though the words aren't actually spelled this way, reading, writing, and arithmetic. Just essentially finding ways to develop a curricula in an after-school setting. And the second part is an actual web-based or online instruction model that will evolve after that. So this group of young people is actually going to be called the DigiCorps, and we're recruiting them now. And the DigiCorps will be these young people who are majoring in everything from French literature to engineering. They'll design lesson plans that involve hip-hop. That's it. So they have to use all the cultural content from hip-hop and think about creative ways of writing a curriculum, even if they've never written a lesson plan. They will be trained to do this with the tutorial and the reader. So I'm going to walk you through. Can someone run the boombox for me? I'm going to walk you through the first part of the hip-hop tutorial. I'm going to ask you some questions, and you better know the answers. I want to know who this first sample is.
Curtis Blow.
I guess I should ask what the under 30s to be quiet. Okay, Grandma and Flash and the Furious Five. Okay, so most everybody remembers this, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, we'll go to the next one. Track two.
More recent?
but considered more underground?
Feel no pain, white hole that controls your brain.
Gotta give you clues here.
That's game, man, we ready for that. Two soldiers headed back, matter of fact, who got the gap? And where my army at? Rather attack and not
travel to South Africa recently, last year or two.
Get sold on sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Whether your projects put on hold in the real world.
Not Bush,
but... just like me and you,
not Live Bush, who is a
real world.
Considered by a lot of people to be real hip-hop. So we've gone through this history the last 20, 25 years of old school, new school, underground, semi-underground, recent, more late. To begin to think about hip-hop as part of an extension of a cultural tradition that began with artistic and social movements that some would say, of course, began with the African presence in the New World, but subsequently the Harlem Renaissance, followed by the bebop movement, followed by the Black Arts movement of the 60s. And in this case, hip-hop. And so what we're trying to inculcate in students is this idea that the tradition lives on. And embedded in hip-hop are all of the tropes, all of the signification that we would find in any other aspect of the Black tradition. So we can mine for things like double consciousness, psychic alienation, cultural maroonage, all the stuff that people of color have been doing for thousands of years gets downloaded into hip-hop, and the tradition is thus being passed on. We also have to talk about some of the things about hip-hop that represent the downside of it, but we're not going to do that today, but normally we do that in class. What happened with me is I had a hip-hop head in the class, in my home rather, and then noticed that we were losing the imagination of the students, and so I, in 98, decided to design a course called Hip-Hop, and the rest is history. As a result of that, of teaching that course, of course, my learning curve has gone just, you know, I mean, I have things in my head that, again, like technology, I had no idea I would be learning these things. But one has to be immersed in the hip-hop underground, and so I've been running around the country, having my daughter's friends escort me through the hip-hop community in various cities around the country. So I've developed this kind of reputation of being the mother. What is this woman doing here? I'm giving hip-hop its props. But at any rate, what subsequently happened when I started the class was that IAAEC was forming. I came up with this idea of the Hip-Hop Tutorial Project. Subsequent to that, at Northeastern, I started something else called the Hip-Hop Library and Archive Project. It's actually the 21st Century Hip-Hop Library and Archive Project. We've gotten grants from the university for that, from the Office of the Provost, to actually set up an archive that will ultimately be cataloged and used, not only in the courses on campus, but with a lot of our outreach programs in the community. We've just heard word that we have yet another grant from the Institute for Race and Justice on our own campus, which is another institute, for another project that is actually much more sociological, which is a two-year study of the hip-hop community's reaction to media controversies. And so we're going to be looking over 2 years at how hip-hoppers actually deal with issues like teenage pregnancy, voting, and about three or four other topics. So we'll be, again, running around the country. The notion here is to try to suggest that there's something much more profound going on in hip-hop than just dark SUVs with dark windows and quadraphonic sound and booming and misogyny and violence. That there's something else very profound going on here. So on that note, I'm just going to pass around these cards to those of you who don't already have the IAAEC card. And I want to take you through the this very quick. Can we cut the lights here? I'm going to boost this one. Just a PowerPoint that I use oftentimes with teachers in training sessions with elementary and secondary, particularly primary and secondary students, but oftentimes people in non-traditional settings. The ESOP Crew Tutor is something that is being developed over time. The ESOP Crew Tutor will come out of a cross-fertilization that happens with other members of IAAEC who are actually working with developing intelligent agents or avatars. So Juan's work, Juan and Skip's work, two of our colleagues, are working on the development of intelligent agents that are culturally specific. So once they've got a handle on that research, my ESOP crew tutor will kick in based on that research. And this will be the online persona that young people will see when they go to the online web-based instructional platform. So this is just a bit to explain that to people. Fact or fiction about hip-hop, we go through what some of those ideas are. Because normally people have stereotypes. Even hip-hop heads themselves have some very inbred attitudes about what their culture is like. Oops, that went ahead too fast, but anyway. Why study hip-hop? These are some reasons why, particularly from the vantage point of students, why it would be interesting to learn the language. The rhymes are dope, the versatility of the freestyler, which again is just a part of the oral tradition, playing the dozens, all of those elemental aspects of the Black tradition that are passed on from one generation to the next. Students learn a great deal, of course, about their history that they didn't know. One of the things I often use in courses is Van Sertima's theory about Africans came to the New World first as masters, then as slaves, because then you get a chance to articulate an African presence in the New World that precedes slavery, that was based on a very different set of premises. And then the idea that hip-hop is both a tradition, an art form, and a social movement. So these are some of the things that come up in the class. Here, usually, if I'm making a presentation, I use KRS-One's I Got Next CD, which is a nice kind of very simple instructional CD for people who might know who he is but haven't really seen him off stage doing something that's got more of an educational edge. This is just to talk a little bit about some of the examples of technology or technological applications that have emerged either as direct innovations of hip-hop or have been appropriated by hip-hop in various ways. So of course, MP3, MP2000 technologies, downloading music, turntablism, which is really a very profound appropriation and innovation of the old school days when the turntable would be disassembled and the experimentation with this dual manipulation of the double turntables and all the other accoutrements that were subsequently developed to produce this innovation. So when you're poor and you don't have stuff, you make stuff up. And so we have this really extraordinary technological application that is practiced everywhere on the planet now with DJs, whether they're in Tokyo or Johannesburg. Rhyming or freestyling, of course, this has spread around the world the way jazz did, b-boying and b-girling. And we just go through the various forms of hip-hop and walk people through it. So they can see it has some dimensionality. It's not just rap. And of course, the spoken word poetry movement that has become one of the really extraordinary elements of hip-hop culture has also spread around the world. There was just a piece on NPR the other day I heard. Spoken word, of course, sort of comes out of Chicago not long ago, and there has been significant collaboration between spoken word poetry collectives around the country, many of which are multicultural, and the prison reform movement. We walk through here just genres of rap, various genres of rap. A video clip from Rhyme or Reason. Sometimes I shift these to some other videos. And then we just kind of wrap up what hip-hop is about. And then with the kids, with students, now we go out and we do our research. So one of the things we are going to be doing with the Hip Hop Tutorial Project in terms of reading, writing, and arithmetic is including introducing students to their own community, their own neighborhood, where in many cases there are underground hip-hop people producing and creating the art form. So there are MCs and DJs in their own community who are just starting out their careers. Everybody's making their own CDs now. The spoken word poetry movement is in almost every major city in the country now. So there's a lot going on inside their own communities that young people have a chance to go out and explore either through video research or by doing oral interviews or all sorts of stuff. And all of this information will come back to Northeastern and will be included in our archive as local-based research. So that's what we're trying to talk here about, the fact that hip-hop is found all over the world. Okay. That's this. Now I'm going to show you a very brief clip, I hope someone can help me, a video clip of a video called Hip Hop, A Culture of Influence, that was produced by a group in New York, an outfit in New York, a couple of years ago. And one of the reasons I like this particular video is that it's not slick, and number two, because it was made by young people themselves, and it interviews young people themselves in the street. So we're just going to look at a brief part of it, not the whole thing. Normally what I also do is I play an excerpt from Osmosis Jones, which I think those of you who used to have kids should have taken to see when it's out, and if not, you can get it on DVD or CD. But Osmosis Jones is a really neat sort of disease crime time video that is an animated film that teaches kids about the human body. And so it's a way of approaching teaching the sciences, particularly about human biology, to kids by using characters and voiceovers that they're familiar with, like Chris Rock and a number of others who play the parts of this virus that's about to take over the body. And Chris Rock is trying to be the crime fighter. And so there are these very interesting ways that we are coming up with, which are applications, multimedia applications, to try to get kids interested in thinking about math, science, technology, and actually every field. The point is, they're not interested in the traditional classroom anymore. Anybody who hasn't figured that out now is brain dead. So we've really got to scurry and come up with some really interesting theoretical and methodological approaches to recapture their attention and their minds. They're already interested in multimedia, but they don't see it as an intellectual pursuit. It's fun, it's entertainment. So we want to take students' built-in access, or programming, if you will, towards these technologies and focus it around curricula that really are going to help them learn what they need to learn to compete in a world that is going to be plagued by some really serious problems. The AIDS pandemic is just one of a gazillion. That's just the tip of the iceberg. So we want to be able to equip them to be smart, to be smarter, and to be the smartest. And because the digital divide is approaching the issue of how people of color and women are disproportionately marginalized, we want to try to come up with ways that increase our capacity to give more and more access to people and give people more and more information about the kinds of ways they can use multimedia technology, not just to go on a chat line or to get a date, which is what a lot of African American women who are online are doing, but to find a job, to find a new place to live, to move to a new city, to find other things in their city to do to help them advance themselves professionally. All those sorts of things to help them in terms of community-based social action projects, to teach people about how to do caucusing and lobbying in their communities to get things done. I remember one of the things that happened when Gingrich came into office as the speaker was they completely dismantled a lot of the professional lobbies that had been in Washington, which meant the Women's Caucus, the Black Caucus, the Latino Caucus, the Art Caucus, all of those groups that were in Washington. And they thought by dismantling their funding that they would kill them. The folk were already online. They were already online, and they simply shifted their applications to doing their lobbying and caucus work through the internet, which in some cases really argued well for them, but they were already organized. And so there are these ways that aren't oftentimes publicized that people do use the internet, multimedia, extremely effectively. And my interest is reminding people that the drum, which is the traditional communications platform of people of African descent, is nothing but ubiquitous computing. When you think about it, it's the same thing. It's ubiquitous computing. So if you can develop this communications platform effectively to achieve an end, you can do ubiquitous computing. And this is the kind of thing that we want to promote more and more in communities of color is networked communities. Get people hooked up and wired, and then get people in to train them and to help them to maintain their interest in the uses of technology. Whether these are African American communities, Latino communities, Asian communities, women's organizations, young girls groups, all of the groups that we know are marginalized, we want to ramp up their technological capacity. So I just want to open up the floor for questions or comments, the little time we have left.
Well, I'm kind of interested in the multicultural aspects that you brought out in the video, and also the global aspects of bringing in. I did get a talk at our school on the panels on otherness, and I kind of brought those same black musical traditions, but I also overlap it with the fact that a lot of what is Latino culture is actually African culture. It's a mixture, and so on. So I'm kind of interested in the fact that there are parallel movements are taking place in other countries as well. I think that's a way to also give young people tools to deal with problems that are increasingly global, and not just, you know, everything starts in the local community, but it may have a global, ramification.
So, I think it's very clear from a social political perspective that globalization is not, it's a bit of a misnomer. It's a advertising cliche that oftentimes misses the fact that globalization is really the last stage in what began as colonialism and imperialism, and is ultimately going to translate into free trade. And isn't necessarily a good thing, particularly for people of color, when you start talking about things like intellectual property rights and resources and developing nations and all this sort of thing, which is the other kind of field of mine. But globalization in the terms of the spread of culture, of African-based culture, what we have to realize is the world has been Africanized. The process of Africanization of the world has happened. It's already happened. And so if you want to talk about the early days of hip-hop, it actually emerges out of the black and Latino community simultaneously. If you actually want to talk about bebop, it emerges out of Tito Puente and Dizzy Gillespie. And a lot of their collaboration. So there's always been this sort of parallel track in terms of the ways in which particularly creative communities of color have identified one another and been working together for quite a long time in some very remarkable kinds of ways, given the marginalization that they've experienced. And so I think it's extremely important to begin to promote the idea of hip-hop as a global process on the positive side, because of so much that's happened that's really extraordinary. I mean, Dead Prez goes to South Africa several years ago, and he's not just interested in sort of kissing the ground of the motherland, he's interested in hooking up with what has been going on in a country that he probably couldn't have gotten into when he was first born because of the new elections in 94. You probably just heard that the Treasury Secretary and what's his name are going on a four-country African trip on not Bon Jovi but Bono are going. They're leaving Sunday. They're going to Ghana, South Africa, Ethiopia, and I can't remember the fourth one. But Bono's notion, which is not a new idea, is to relieve debt. And the West, of course, has been uninterested in relieving debt because they think it's going to encourage people to continue to pilfer the funds of the IMF and the World Bank. And the situation in Ghana has essentially proven that if they take those same funds that would have been paid toward debt relief and apply them to create infrastructure in their countries, you suddenly have lots of clinics and lots of schools and lots of roads and lots of other stuff people are going to need to compete in the digital world, in the globalized world, in the global neighborhood. So at this point, I don't care who does what. I don't care what color they are. As long as they begin to address themselves to the mounting issues, all of which are related to poverty. Everything boils down to poverty. And the spiritual disease, if you will, associated with it, which is greed and materialism, which we do really well here. You don't have 80% of the world's resources controlled by 20% of the world's population, mostly us in Europe, without realizing there's something wrong with that picture. Without realizing that it creates impoverishment, it creates underclasses, it recreates poverty over and over. In the early 90s, the United Nations Conference on Population, which had essentially been designed by the developing nations, was commandeered by the developing nations. And they said, well, fine, if you want to talk about population because you think all the brown people in the world are having too many babies, we want to talk about consumption because we think you guys are eating off the planet.
Exactly.
So they managed to shift the title of the conference to the United Nations Conference on Population and Consumption. Now, I'm sitting watching a CNN panel before the conference, which was held in Cairo, and there's a whole line of really wonderful experts. They weren't politicos, they were all experts. And there was this absolutely gorgeous Nigerian woman who hadn't said a word in the whole panel. I thought, right, an airhead, you know, she's not going to have anything. Well, sister lady got up at the end and she said, if the rich people of the world do not share their wealth with the poor will share their poverty with the rich. It's already happening, okay? She was head of women's organizations. She was a chief. She was head of women's organizations in Nigeria. But I think that phenomena has already taken very powerful hold, like a parasite of the world. And so when we look at it, it's poverty. And when we look at ways to alleviate, the immediate way to alleviate poverty, it's by starting with young people and providing educational opportunities for them, however we define education, in both the classic formal sense and in the non-traditional informal sense. And the informal aspects of African American and Latino and Asian and women's culture that gets inculcated in the home as we're raising are as important to our schooling, particularly spiritually and psychologically and emotionally, as are learning how to do trigonometry or speak another language. So what we're trying to do is, what I'm trying to do is convey this idea of a level playing field with the disciplines, which I was brought to kicking and screaming because my undergraduate degree was in studio art and art history, my master's degree was in education, my PhD was in sociology. Go figure that out. So I had to work on those crossroads very well. I had to kind of figure those out. In addition to the fact that my background culturally is just very mixed, probably less of an African person than I am Sioux and German Jew and Cherokee and God knows what else, just lots of stuff in there, Scottish. And growing up in that sort of an environment, you learn a lot. You learn a lot about how to consolidate, how to unite, how to find areas of common cause, how to identify with people on a very human kind of level. And there are more and more people on the planet like that. And there's more and more of us who may call ourselves double-digit or hyphenated this or that. But we're number one global citizens. So that's pretty much what the hip hop tutorial is really kind of about, trying to give kids a chance to have some fun and to do something interesting and creating something that I'm calling this sort of multi-level learning community, where you've got senior faculty working with junior faculty, working with lecturers, working with students, working with young people in the community in primary and secondary schools. So everybody's sort of learning. There's no way I could have done anything in hip hop if I hadn't become a student and said, who? DMX who? What? If I hadn't initially gone through that experience of driving down the street or whenever it was, maybe the late 80s, and hearing the vibration, you know, and going, why don't they like put on some good music? And then seeing, you know, the TV with the darkened windows and the quadraphonic sound, and the cars just like boom. And kind of really being turned off by that until I was forced to listen to it. You know, mom, there's more to it than that. You're not listening to the words. And so that's kind of the way I came into the experience. Yes?
You know, my position's kind of different because, you know, I'm really an outreach and developmental type of work. So it's community-based and dealing with students.
Right.
And the ultimate goal for me is to increase the number of students that will be attending institutes of higher education.
Right.
So that being the case, you know, especially selective institutes of higher education, UCLA, you know, whatever the school is. So that being the case, you know, we know that in order for them to succeed here, they have to have certain skills. They have to have the ability to write. They have to have the ability to translate, you know, whatever it is, if it's in math and science, and that's what my background, I'm an engineer. But they have to be able to translate those types of things. So, you know, I work with Renee on another project, this is the Urban Collaborative. And one of the things that we're looking at in terms of the research agenda is that in order to connect with the students, it has to be something that they have a lot of interest in, which is hip-hop is something that everybody's interested in. So, I can understand, that maybe as a means to teach some students how to do research, to improve their writing skills. Ultimately, though, the byproduct is that they can gain access to the university to assume the leadership roles that we need in the community. You know, right now in California, 15,000 African Americans in LA County started high school in 97, and 2000, only 9,000 graduated. Of the 9,000 that graduated, only 428 were admitted to the UC system. And then with Prop 209 and other things, we even cut into that further. So what does it take? Is it more important for us to create a student that can't compete, and that even if they use the hip-hop culture or someone uses the classical culture to acquire the skills that are necessary to read and write, do arithmetic, or whatever? So my thing is, how can we take this and develop some kind of curriculum or course that would support us developing the skills that these young folks need in order to compete in this global society, globalization process?
Number one, we premiered the hip-hop tutorial in the Cullen Middle School in Houston in October. Mm-hmm. And it was really successful. I think much more successful than any of us expected. Stafford was in that session as an assessment person. And initially, I did an all-school assembly, and that was followed by a selective workshop with 25 kids, where we used hip-hop content with some math exercises to have them do math problems. I mean, it really was like watching a miracle unfold, because they took to it like fish to water. They worked in groups well. They problem-solved well. They were computer-literate enough to be able to solve the problems. They were enthusiastic and energetic, because it was different. It was something they knew. They knew who Eve was. So do a scheduling routine around Eve. Do a listening exercise with a number of samples on a mixtape, and based on graph theory. What you're listening to, find that on a particular graph. Which graph fits the sample that you're listening to. It's very simple stuff, and that's why my idea of the DigiCore is built on a couple of principles. Number one, if you get college-age kids to interface with primary and secondary kids in the community, they really like the younger face. I mean, they're not going to diss me, but they'd much rather look at someone who's closer to their age and who's not so intimidating and threatening, and who they assume might kind of understand them and have greater simpatico with. So that's why I developed the idea of the DigiCore, that we can capture college-age students, particularly juniors and seniors, once they've really achieved a certain plateau of experience in their discipline, whether it's engineering or mathematics or, as I said, French literature, can be absolutely anything, and have them use their discipline to develop a lesson plan. And what I ask them to do is I ask them to do a pre-instruction lesson plan. So I want to see what's in their head. A lot of them will come up with stuff without any instruction. It needs to be fine-tuned in terms of a solid lesson plan, learning objectives, and thinking about those kinds of things. But basically, they have lots of ideas. What would you do if you were sitting in front of 10 kids and you wanted to teach them a couple of engineering ideas that you learned when you were a freshman? How would you use hip-hop to inculcate that? You'd be amazed how creative they get. So they will be trained to then go into non-traditional settings in the fall to actually do that, a team of them. So the curriculum is already being developed now. The DigiCore college students will be trained this summer and early fall, and they'll be out there, and so the package will be ready. We're a little bit slower on the web-based instruction because it's just going to involve more technology.
See, I wanted to ask you, maybe I could be way off on this, but the California Department of Education has standards, and it says that, that a student that's taken algebra should understand the quadratic equation,
sure,
and know how to use the quadratic equation.
Right.
And we know that understanding and knowing the quadratic equation, and maybe the why as to what's the logic behind the quadratic equation, mm-hmm, is necessary in order for a student to deal with, say for instance, things on the SAT,
right,
things on the ACT,
right,
critical thinking types of things. Mm-hmm. So I'm saying, is it possible, is that too confining for what you're saying, to take the hip hop culture tutorial and have, say, a group of students take the standards that a student is supposed to know at a particular grade level and build lesson plans around getting those students to better, you know, master the standard.
It's a piece of cake. It's a piece of cake. The trick is, I'm a couple of generations away from understanding particular applications of the quadratic equation in hip hop. The college age people are not. The immediacy of ideas that they have, because of their immersion as hip hoppers themselves, which I am not, allows them to creatively think about ways in which they can use stuff, information, data they know about hip hop to an idea in their discipline or field. So it doesn't matter if it's the quadratic equation or the Pythagorean theorem or what mathematical theory. They'll come up with it. They already have. I mean, and it wasn't even brain drain. It's like, oh yeah, well, that's kind of like, and it's just, that's why it's so much fun to watch it, is because you sort of sit there and you go, why didn't I think of this before? This is so obvious, you know? The other thing about it is that we're focusing on non-traditional settings and after-school programs, so we're not trying to mess too much with school standards, except to know about and select out those elements of scholastic knowledge that they do need to know for testing, if you want to deal with that strategy for assessment. And pick out some of those very important theoretical ideas that kids are supposed to know in the various disciplines. And it's not just math and science and engineering. It's all fields. They're supposed to know certain things. How could you take, an idea in cultural theory from a particular classic of American literature and apply it to hip-hop? My students in the hip-hop class read Octavia Butler's Parable of the Sower. And, you know, there's like, you read pages, you know, chapter one this week and chapter. My problem is getting them not to read ahead. Now, this is a generation that doesn't read. They're smart. They just don't read. You know they don't read, you know? So if you don't ask them to write journals and do assignments every week, they won't read. They'll get all their information from a research paper off the web. Try to hand you in a web biography that's like 3 pages long. You say, don't you read any books? Well, I don't have to. So one of the things I'm also trying to do is, you know, return back to this initial idea started with, how many of you have actually written a letter in the last 10 years? How many of them have actually read a book? Well, if you take a book like this from an African-American science fiction writer whose content really comes out of a kind of descriptive speculation, if you will, less than science fiction, about post-Holocaust LA, what it would look like, and a kind of rite of passage that this young woman goes through, as she finds successfully her way through this Holocaust experience that's described in the book. The kids begin to understand that as the experience they're having in terms of trying to confront chthonic chaos. Those of us who are over 50 or baby boomers might not feel chthonic chaos, but I'll tell you, when a young Palestinian girl straps a bomb to her chest and she's an A student and wants to go to college and has a fiance and goes and blows herself up, I think there's something very wrong with that. And all of the homicide, suicide, and escalating issues that we're dealing with young people are a warning sign to us that something is really very wrong. And if it's not going to get any better, if we can't do anything to stave off the destruction that's happening, we can at least prepare kids with tools to fight it and resist it and survive, and in fact thrive. So I don't know that everything that they will need to know in the future is going to happen in the traditional classroom. I'm not saying they shouldn't be there. I'm not saying we shouldn't make the schools better. But I don't think we can count on that. We can't put our eggs there. And projects like this attempt to deal with kids in their own turf, around their own cultural knowledge, with their own peers, and redefine learning. One of the books I can share with you is written by a colleague at my institution, Peter Morrell. It's called African-Centered Pedagogy, Developing Schools of Achievement for African-American Children. And this is a really interesting presentation on the theoretical and pedagogical issues that are involved in culturally specific or culture-based learning. That Peter has really developed out of working with teachers who work with students in this kind of learning community model that we're kind of really obsessed with at Northeastern right now. I don't know if anybody understands what it is, and they may be wasting a lot of money, but we're trying to experiment with what a learning community really is. It's no longer just a teacher and a student. I remember when I was a Fulbright in South Africa and I was teaching at the University of Witwatersrand, it took me at least 4 months to adjust to the learning modality. which is the British model. You stand up at the podium and you talk for an hour or two. And they write down every period, dot, comma, and sigh that you make. They do not ask you any questions. They do not critically analyze or interrogate you about anything you said or thought. And they then spit it out and regurgitate it on tests. And I think that's pretty much dysfunctional at this point. I think we need to find other ways to teach and learn and other ways to measure and assess what's been mm-hmm. taught and learned. Who's doing the teaching? Who's doing the learning? And that it's much more of a circular kind of spiral process now, or it has to be, because problems are accelerating so much, we're feeling more and more helpless, because you help one kid and then they're 10. You make the difference in the lives of certain select kids in a particular school, and there's six other schools that are in the toilet. So I think we have to look at quality of life issues. We have to look at quality of life issues for teachers. Teachers have to be rewarded suddenly for doing the wonderful work that they do. We have to begin to overvalue them in a way more than we do, you know, corporate potentates and other people who make fat salaries. We've got to completely realign how we think about learning, the learning experience, because there are other things that they need to learn with regards to, for example, the AIDS pandemic. Yes, we need biologists and epidemiologists to study research, but then we need social workers to come with really creative solutions to social welfare issues, to do AIDS education in rural communities in South Africa. So they come up with this model where they parent a Western trained medical doctor with a Sangoma, because the people in the rural areas, they'll trust the medical doctor, but they do trust the Sangoma. Sangoma, if he or she has been AIDS educated, can then pass on very valuable information like, gee, no, you can't get rid of AIDS by having sex with a virgin. So, you know, the kinds of things that people need to learn, and not people who are stupid, it's just people who don't know. And their traditions and their mythologies and their old stereotypic ideas prevent them from actually. So as far as I'm concerned, the top's off, the ceilings are gone, the floor's gone, and we need to try lots of things.
See, the other thing I was going to add is that we, in Southern California, in California as a whole, you know, school-based is not necessarily the answer for us, because it's particularly if we're interested in African-American students and trying to do something there, you know, because they're so scattered and diverse that we can't make a connection, and we lose,
yes,
like you said, one school, six schools. So our affiliations are trying to do what we can do through community-based organizations mm-hmm. that are committed, you know, with,
yes,
with the support of like faculty types of people, and developing curriculums. Like you referred to, like the AIDS, we have a curriculum in health issues that's being taught by a PhD here mm-hmm. at a community school where they're studying all the different environmental, HIV, and all these different issues, and then they're visiting community sites and clinics that are trying to address those problems, and those students are picking one of the problems that they would like to and making that a project.
Right.
And developing, you know, something on it. So I mean, that kind of stuff is happening. But again, it's relative to trying to provide some structure. And the thing that we like to do is have value on it. So mm-hmm. if it's a college course or credit or something like that, we try to legitimize it like that, so
yes,
we can put it on the student's transcript,
yes,
so they can gain admission.
So it's not just anonymous service.
Right. We want to just add value to them mm-hmm. some kind of way. And then that's that way they make commitment. I understand what you're saying about the standards and, you know, not just focusing on education, but really creating somebody that's going to be add to the quality of life,
right, right,
by society.
Right. I mean, you see, what's going to happen with hip hop tutorial is once they go on to online education, they'll be able to go on and brag about how they just did research in their community. They just did a videotape survey of baby boomers, their elderly people's attitudes about hip-hop music.
Mm-hmm.
And what they decided to do as a subsequent project was actually teach, you know, their elders about hip-hop. But they had to do lesson plans, and they had to write this, and they had to research that. And they had to crunch data, not a big data set, but a little data set. And they had fun. It was
mm-hmm.
a lot of work, but they had fun. And so the idea is to try to get them to work really hard to learn stuff, but not notice that they're doing all these things, because it's about something that they know a lot about, all right, so they feel a very high level of capacity. but they don't realize how much capacity they have. And so part of this is to try to get young people to look at their own knowledge base, see how much stuff you already know. I remember in an early classroom at Northeastern asking a question of my class, did any of you in any of the communities you ever grew up know anybody in your community who did herb or did root? Did you ever hear of like the Obey Man or anything? So it's a long, long silence and nobody's saying anything. Everybody's looking at everyone else and you sort of figure out what's going on because it's a classroom of mostly predominantly African-American and Latino students, both communities of which have people who do root. And slowly and gradually they came out of the closet. Said, oh yeah, that was Miss Johnson who lived down on such and such a road and we were told to kind of stay away from her, but she used to go to church, so my mama said she was kind of okay too. But people used to go to her. They would go to the medical doctor, but they also go to her too. So I said, well, what does that mean to you? So one of the things when we're processing it is, first of all, they're ashamed of that because it feeds into the Western notion of stereotypes about witchcraft and hoodoo and voodoo and non-substantiated, non-validated religious practices. It flies in the face of certain Christian traditions that poo-poo that sort of thing. And so I'm trying to get people to think about what knowledge is and the fact that you already have in your experience lots of stuff that you know that you don't realize is perhaps important and has kind of made you a whole integrated person, even though you may not have used it, that this gives you a better picture, a fuller dimension of the capacity of the African-American community to get things done and to also be in and of itself a very diverse community. So I think there are lots of things that I've discovered in trying to develop ideas for curriculum, in whether it's in higher education or other projects I've done. I get people to think about what knowledge is. Don't capture out of the mental trash can a lot of stuff that you just dumped in there because you didn't think it was important. And you find out that perhaps it's going to be the thing that's going to save your life one day. Being able to stand up and do the dozens with someone is a rather serious capacity.
Yeah.
I mean, because it's about a lot of things. It's not just about having a big mouth. It's about being witty.
Yeah.
It's about realizing where the line is when you diss someone's mother. It's about realizing you're not really dissing someone's mother, because if you were, everybody would be dead, because you don't diss mama. It's about speed. It's about being thick-skinned. It's about being able to stand in front of a group and be challenged and stand up on your own. I mean, this is a pretty intense skill that not a lot of African American and Latino young people have, which is why they can stand up on a hip hop stage and talk a lot of trash. It's because they have the skill. They have the skill. It's just oral tradition. It's public speaking. You know, it's culturally specific public speaking. But a kid like that then goes and joins the debate club and has all this wonderful poise and capacity. So we need to think about those things. Mm-hmm. Black kids, Latino kids, Asian kids have a lot more stuff happening that we need to validate as knowledge.
Yeah. You said Houston is a site that you're working on?
We started there, yeah, because we have some IAAC colleagues there.
Is there an idea to develop a national or model within a national kind of thing so we could into LA? I think I haven't heard of it before.
Well, just started, really.
Yeah, and I think it's interesting because...
Yeah, we're trying to get a handle on Boston.
Okay.
Particularly because Boston is the oldest public school system in the country. There are more colleges and universities per square mile than any place else on the planet. And you would think, with all that intelligence, that it'd be the best public school system in the country. I mean, you know, dare I have that sort of assumption or expectation. But I think we should have those sorts of expectations. And it simply means that we haven't thought about interesting enough ideas to use. And perhaps going into the schools isn't the only option. That's why I've been focusing my attention on community-based organizations and non-traditional settings, in which you can also oftentimes involve a lot of non-traditional teachers. You get elderly people in the community involved in a teaching capacity or in an assistive capacity in many ways. There are networked communities. We've got a project, one of our IT IAAC colleagues, Randall Pinkett, has developed a residential ubiquitous learning community, computer learning community, where the project that was just built, the new project, has a computer-based center that's not only equipped with workstations, but it's got two young people, technicians who are in there like 24/7. And everybody comes in there to learn how to do stuff. And everybody's house is wired. And that's unusual for African American and Latino communities. But there it is, it's a model, it works. How do we reproduce the model? How do we reproduce the model? So absolutely, once we get a handle on it in Boston, then we're gonna develop a hookup with Houston, and then we'll kind of go global, sure.
What kind of time frame are you talking about?
Within a year. Funding? Money? Any money?
I connect to LA now.
We'll see. We'll see. I mean, there's a lot of projects running around, and so, you know, this is going to be a relatively high investment for people, but not extraordinarily. I mean, $50,000 would get us, you know, really started off. So it may have to start off with foundation grants, which have been shifting their focus in the last year anyway. Their foundations and philanthropic organizations are not giving as much to higher education as they used to. But they are giving to higher education projects that are very intricately connected with schools, particularly primary and secondary education. That's where they want to put their money now, primary and secondary education. So we have to come up with very creative partnerships that involve community organizations and schools. And I think that if we can get multi-year funding to do these kinds of things, it will work well.
Well, thank you.